the driver had taken off. It was still best to check it out and leave nothing to chance. Carl needed help. It was a small, locked box engraved with the letters WH. Carl thought about taking it. Nothing was to be left to chance. Such heart-wrenching Nordic poetry, that was. But Carl didn't care much about flowery language. What could be inside that envelope? Carl was taken aback. He knew this address. An explosion suddenly occurred outside. Carl knew that Gilles Lachance was in charge of the general store. According to that log, it seemed like the whole village owed some money to the general store. Carl was... Something fell to the bottom of the box. The murder weapon. What was that doing there, Carl wondered. Hamilton must have been determined to keep some information secret to post this key. Shame he got unlucky. Everything made sense now. Poor Hamilton's denunciation was interrupted, and he figured it would be best to lock everything. Carl wondered what the hell could that thing be. It looked like a man fossilized in ice. All of a sudden, Carl felt like he was pulled inside a world of dreams, a cold, unknown dimension. Somehow, Self-control was slipping from his grasp. To all appearances, this was a hunting log. Better yet, a war diary. What could these engraved numbers mean? A fresh path suddenly appeared before Carl. Your frozen hands in hot water. What happened? Now at least he knew who the unfortunate man petrified in ice was. Gilles Lachance, the general. The otherworldly ice had struck again. The woman's hopes and dreams were frozen in eternity. It seemed like secrecy was commonplace in this house. Vision's veil was lifted, and he was back to reality. A reality in which... Carl had seen that kind of safe before, with its double... True Catholic always strives to keep lowly temptations at bay. Obviously, Carl thought, someone in... The Bedards had vacated the premises. Jean-Luc Bedard had without a doubt been the closest man in the village to William Hamilton. Hay stub for some undoubtedly harsh lumberjack work. The key, which seemed to be meant for a padlock, bore an inscription reading Clouté et Fils. There should be a law forbidding doctors from falling sick. A communist manifesto. Only a few years ago, this type of allegiance meant prison time.
M'amènerais bon galon de caribou, puis on devient amis. Sinon, mon petit gars, tu sors avant que je te sorte. Vois-tu le livre, là? C'est le Wendigo.
Back then, in Africa and elsewhere, people were ready to take up arms to stand against the yoke of English imperialism. In Montreal, mailboxes were blown up, abductions were carried out, and violent manifestos were distributed to media outlets. But around here, in the great northernmost, all a man could do is curse out loud against the faraway evil and pray for the revolution to arise. That man, by any reckoning, was from that very stock. It ain't Jean Blouin. Seems like that pig had a name after all. Roswell, Atamipec,
Sims.
The week of October 5th, thought Carl. That was this week. The plug should have been here by now. The very first steps of man on the moon were made more than a year ago. something very important must have been in there for the man to take such time and effort to hide it. But Carl didn't know how to reach it. Carl had no idea how to interpret a message like that. On the surface, it seemed like he had one. The plot thickened like water into ice. A sudden cold snap struck Carl, who felt like he was pulled into a dream. He had been running in fear. It seemed as though Regin had been ready to take up arms and slay people like Hamilton. Pierre the Poacher Bleu was definitely not the one who lived here.